Hi, everybody. How's everybody doing tonight? Awesome. I couldn't be more excited to be here. Paul Cummins is an American icon. He's our Dewey. He's done amazing things for the country's education philosophy and visions of what education can be, particularly innovative, progressive education. And particularly wonderful for us in Santa Monica and Malibu in this area because of the schools he's created and the many things he's done to make our communities better with those schools. And also a perfect time, and we'll talk about that more later, but there's so much that's exciting going on in the Malibu community. There couldn't be a better time to have this conversation. So thank you, Laura. Thank you, the City Council. Thank you, LA County Libraries, for making this possible. So I want to introduce Dr. Cummins. He's president and CEO of the Coalition for Engaged Education. He has a BA from Stanford, a master's degree from Harvard, and a PhD from USC. In 1971, he co-founded the Crossroads School in Santa Monica. He was there until 1995 when he founded the New Visions Foundation, and at the same time, the New Road School in Santa Monica. Books he's written include Proceeding with Passion, Engaging Students in Meaningful Education. I just love these titles. Two Americas, Two Educations, Funding Quality Schools for All Students, Why Poetry, Reflections on Poetry, Writing, and Culture. And the most recent book, which is just out and will be available to be signed later, Confessions of a Headmaster, My Pursuit of Joy and Justice in Education. Spectacular. Okay, so Why don't we jump right in? Enough of listening to me. I want to take you back to 1971. Richard Nixon is president. We've just, Supreme Court has just allowed busing, and we've just opened trade relations with China. And you get this idea to start a school. And you start this school, you've got two rooms in a Baptist church, 32 kids, only seventh and eighth grade. Tell me about that.
I've got this thing on, so can you all hear me? Okay, if not, shout out. And if I have friends out there who are waving at me without my distance glasses, I can't see you. So, and it's not that I'm snubbing you. I'd have to go back a little before 1971, I'll try and do it really quickly and be mindful of our time. But I went off to Stanford as an undergraduate in 1955, a kid who really was a-intellectual. I wasn't even anti-intellectual. I didn't even know what it meant to be intellectual. There weren't books in my home. My parents didn't read particularly, and we didn't discuss ideas at home. So I went off to Stanford in the days when you could get into Stanford with a fairly strong pulse and a little parental influence. Just to tell you the difference, the tuition when I went there as a freshman in 1955 was $225 a quarter. So my poor father had to spend $775 to send me to Stanford for a year. And I went off thinking I was going to play football, which after 2 weeks of freshman football, that was, I realized that wasn't going to happen. Two things happened that had a profound impact on my life. I met a student standing in line to register at Stanford, he asked me, he said, "What are you reading?" And I said, "What do you mean? Classes haven't started." And he kind of rolled his eyes like, "Oh my God, how did this idiot get into Stanford? He thinks you can't read a book unless it's been assigned to you by a teacher." So I registered, and I'm walking back to the dorm, and I feel this guy comes up, grabs me by the elbow, and says, "Come here, I'm going to do you a favor." And he walks me. I was so shocked. I went with him. He walks me over to the bookstore, goes in, comes out, hands me a paperback book, George Orwell's Animal Farm. And I think he figured, well, it's short. The margins are, you know, margins are kind of big. It's about animals, and it's kind of simple on the surface. And so I read it, and he came over and explained to me that it had something to do with Russian history and so on. So he said, here, read this for I'll give you 2 days for this. But now I'm sort of shocked by this guy, who was kind of this geeky intellectual kid who was my classmate. He was in the freshman also. The second book he gave me was Catcher in the Rye, J.D. Salinger. I read it, loved it. He came over and we talked about teenage alienation, and I was starting to get interested in this. And so then at the end of that discussion, he handed me my third book, Classes Haven't Started Yet, which was Orwell's 1984. And once I started reading it, I could barely put it down. It was one of the most, for me at that time, most terrifying books that I'd ever read. And I think if you just change the title of it to, 2084, the book is still a really incredible read. Well, we had a great discussion about that, and so that was happening. And this young guy, John, what is his name, John Harris, decided I was going to be his project. He was going to take, a sow's ear and make a silk purse out of it somehow. Then the second thing happened, I was placed in a Western Civ section. You went to big lectures a couple times a week, and then you had your section. And my section was this kind of small room with about 12 of us in there with a big stage kind of up in front. And walking across it was this kind of mean-looking guy with big, thick glasses and a scowl on his face, Daniel Smith. And first day of class, Daniel Smith, I'm getting to 1971. Daniel Smith asked a question. I raised my hand. I'm this sort of idiot high school kid. And he looks at me after I give my answer, and this visible sneer comes on his face, and he says, "What a pedestrian comment." I'll never forget. And so I kind of shut up, and after class, I went over to the library and got the dictionary out with the pedestrian, and I didn't quite understand. I went back and told John what had happened, and he rolled his eyes again, and he said, "God, you're so dumb, you don't even know when you've been insulted." And I said, "No, I know I've been insulted." And I could tell by his tone of voice, I just didn't understand the insult. So he explained to me pedestrian common, someone who walks on the streets and whatever. I thought, oh, great, now I know the insult. And so it went with, I'll telescope it, so it went with Daniel Smith for 3 quarters. And I found myself going out and reading books. And if he assigned a chapter, I'd read the whole book. If he assigned a paragraph, I'd read the chapter. I was going out reading extra to try and someday show Daniel Smith I wasn't really stupid, which was pretty hard because I was at the time. And I'll never forget one spring quarter. He asked a question. It was a unit on Marxism, and I'd gone out and read an entire book by Sidney Hook. I still can remember the cover of the book. And I answered his question, and he looked at me, and he went like that. I thought, oh, my God, this is better than throwing 3 touchdown passes. Daniel Smith acknowledged that I said something intelligent. So last day of class, I look at him and I want to say something. I know he's changed my life, but I don't quite understand fully yet. But I was too shy to say anything, and he was completely socially inept. I found out that he got fired that summer for getting drunk at a faculty party and going after the department chair's wife. And so I never saw him again. And I could never find him to thank him. This was many years later. But I started to leave the classroom, and I looked at him, and he looked at me, and he said, "Cummins." And I said, "Yes." And I walked up to his desk, and he said, "What are you going to major in?" And I said, "Gee, I don't know." He said, "Well, you might consider history." And then he started shuffling papers, because that was the best he could do as a compliment. I went right over to the registrar and declared a history major right on the spot. Flash forward, and now I'm getting closer to 1971. 3 years later, it's 1958. I'm sitting in a history lecture, and I'll jump 20 years later, whatever. It's one of these theater seating lecture halls. And I'm the lecturer, I remember Thomas Andrew Bailey, a wonderful historian, but I wasn't hearing him. I completely zoned out, and I was writing like crazy. And the bell rang, and I kind of came out of my trance, my zone, whatever it was. And I looked, and I had been outlining a curriculum for the high school that I wished I had gone to. And I looked at it, and it was one of those sort of aha moments. And I actually called my dad that night and said, you know, told him that I think I want to go into education. And my dad, who was wonderful, said, you know, whatever makes you happy, son, blah, blah. He really had wanted me to go to law school, come back and run the family business, which would have been a problem because in my senior year, his business tanked and there was no family business to come home to. But by then, that's not what I wanted to do. So I started thinking about what my high school education might have been. And so when I got an offer in 1970, I had been a teacher at Harvard School for 7 years, teaching English, which I was loving. Got fired from Harvard School because the headmaster was sort of going through turmoil himself at that time, and I crossed him at the wrong moment, and he blew up at me. It was kind of weird. But anyway, I'm so glad it happened because I'd probably still be teaching English there. So I then went over to Oakwood School, which was a kind of very progressive school, and got a call from this little elementary school in Santa Monica, St. Augustine by the Sea. And they were looking for a new headmaster. I took the job. And I came into this elementary school, and I didn't know much about elementary education at the time, but I knew I didn't like what I saw there. There were five rows of five desks, a teacher at the blackboard, kids in uniforms. They had, when they left the classroom, they had to walk in a column of twos with their hands clasped behind their back. It was an adult's idea of what's appropriate for children, you know, orderly cleanliness and raise your hand, don't speak unless you're, you know, called upon, all that. And it just, this to me, I looked at it, this is not a child's world at all. And so when they were interviewing, they asked me what would I want to do if I were hired, and I wrote down kind of my 10-point plan, figuring I'd never hear from them again. What I didn't realize, it was you know, late April, they were desperate, I had a nice pedigree from, you know, degrees from Stanford, Harvard, so on, and I had been a sort of Episcopalian at one point in my life, very loosely speaking. And so they kind of looked the other way. They never, their hiring committee never came out to Oakwood, where I was the assistant head at the time. And this was Oakwood in the late 1960s. So these were, you know, this was, they're almost a cliche of the 60s, you know, the holes of the tie-dye shirts and the long hair and kids on their lawn playing guitar and singing Bob Dylan, all, you know, it was just, but they never came out and looked at that. And if they had, they never would have hired me. So I gave them my 10-point plan, which was to individualize instruction, have learning stations, to have diversity of the student body, to bring in arts classes and have a diversity of arts classes and so on. Well, they hired me, and so then they all went off for their summer vacations. And so the school enrollment had been going way the hell down. So I needed to build the, I hired teachers on the basis of a fully enrolled school with an increase in tuition. So I had 2 months to find a student body or I was in deep doo-doo. And so I was going around giving talks on the radio, running ads and everything. And there was a principal of Canyon Elementary School in Santa Monica who was alienating. I should build a statue to her, a monument, because if it weren't for her driving people out of Canyon Elementary, I never would have filled up my little elementary school. I managed to fill up the school that summer, and the parents came back in September, and they got their rosters and visited, and they looked at their rosters, and there were these strange names for that particular parent body. Cohen, Goldberg, I mean, what the hell are these people doing at our nice little Episcopal school? I was accepting whoever wanted to come. And so anyway, 1971, I'm there now. A group of parents in the sixth grade, because it was K-6 at the time, that subsequently it became K-5, came to me and said, "We love the changes you're making." They loved it, a lot of the new people. The old guard were pulling out one after the other. So there was this incredible, you know, kind of turnover. And when I was first hired, the chairman of the board, who he and I politically were probably at opposite ends of the spectrum, but I liked him and he liked me for some reason. And he decided that the school's enrollment was so going down that he was just going to take his chances on me. And that was the school was going to sink or swim under my leadership. And I was young and full of ideas. And so he decided to back me. And he said, look, you've got 17 teachers here. I probably shouldn't tell the story, but what the hell. And he said, the kindergarten, first grade, and Spanish teacher are untouchable. He said, the other 14, look them over, and if you want to make some changes, okay. So I did. I interviewed all 14, watched them teach, and I fired 14 teachers and out of 14. And, you know, Frank, my board chairman, said, look them over. I didn't say, you know, clean house. I said, Frank, they're not, you know, they're not tuned into children. So anyway, there was a lot of turmoil that first year. People were leaving. People were coming. The faculty was new. I made a few mistakes and so made some changes after that. And then during the second year, now the kindergarten teacher retired, the first grade teacher moved, and the Spanish teacher decided to stop teaching. So I had 17 out of 17 were new, including a music teacher who I thought was so good, I married her. They didn't want to lose her. I remember walking around the school one day in the second year and thinking, you know what, this is a really good place now. And so subsequently it became Crossroads Elementary and so on. So a lot of stuff, Craig, was happening. People say, did you have a vision of Crossroads becoming the Crossroads that it became? And the true answer is only partially. I mean, a lot of what I was up against in those days was just survival. Raising enough money to get from Monday to Tuesday and building an enrollment. When we moved the Crossroads campus to the 21st Street, 21st Street, we'd get a building and I couldn't afford it, so we'd take in more students, which meant that we'd outgrow the building, which meant we had to get another building. In order to afford that, we'd have to take in more students, which meant we'd outgrow that. And so it was a race. And I always kept thinking, oh, someday we'll find a, you know, 20-acre campus with babbling brooks and beautiful willow trees and so on. Well, it never happened, so the school stayed right where it was. But then I started, I guess what was motivating me in part was some of my own experiences, because I found myself looking back on my own education and realizing three things about myself. One was that I was kind of a slow learner. It took me longer to learn things than some of my classmates. My roommate, who had gone to Andover and who was a brilliant writer, he would get A's with, you know, hardly breaking a sweat. And I would just work my tail off in the same class to get a B. I also realized that I'm probably, I was a late bloomer. It didn't happen until college. And then finally an overachiever. My test scores were always sort of mediocre, kind of in the middle. And I realized that I was really lucky to have grown up in the 50s. I was ninth grade through 12th grade in high school, 51 to 55. Freshman in college to senior in college, 55 to 59. So educationally, I was a product of the 50s. And SAT scores weren't all that important then. I got into Stanford with a mediocre GPA and terrible SATs. I didn't even know what they were, because they apparently got mailed home and my parents didn't know what they were, and so they probably filed them somewhere. I never saw them. And so I go back to my old high school, and one day I'm looking for a kid's file, and I get into the alumni file by mistake, and I pull out my thing, I open it up, and I'm like, oh my God, are you kidding me? I couldn't believe how bad they were. And then I was depressed for weeks thinking, how can I be teaching these kids when they're all smarter than I am? But it also gave me a sense of compassion for kids who aren't good test takers. So bravo if you're a great test taker. But if you're not, I kind of feel like I had the time in the 50s to find out who I was. And so one of the things I wanted to provide at Crossroads was to give kids the time to discover who they are and not put them under such academic pressure that they have no opportunity to explore any, to go down any roads less traveled by, or to go down any by roads, or follow any kind of hobbies or interests that they might have, because they have to go five academic solids, go to English, to history, to math, to science, lunch, to foreign language, and this and that, and then go home and do tons of homework. And where's the joy in that? And so the couple things that I wanted to provide when we launched Crossroads and in new schools that I still consult with and work with is to keep asking ourselves, are we giving kids an opportunity for a little bit of self-discovery? And do they wake up in the morning looking forward to going to school? Well, what a long-winded answer to 1971.
You know? That was awesome.
So I'll pause there for a minute.
I got to catch my breath now. That was amazing. So I think I want to ask about the solids and the other ones you talked about.
Yeah, I've kind of come up with my own little catchphrase that I've included, I think, in Confessions. I think it might be there. I can't remember. But I've just finished up another manuscript that I'm sort of editing and having some people look at, entitled Engaged Education. And it occurs to me that, and fortunately, the pendulum is now swinging back a little bit away from this testing kids to death, you know, the drill and kill mentality. And apparently that seems to be opening up and loosening up a little bit, which is good. I talked to a lot of my friends who are in public education, and they say, well, you know, not quite so fast, buddy. It's still a whole lot of pressure on us, the whole testing thing. And the testing is primarily focused on language arts and mathematics. Not a lot of testing on science, history, and foreign language. But those are the so-called five solids. And I believe that there's five other, what should be solids. I call them the five other solids. And I think they're every bit as important as the five. But they're invariably, they're called extracurricular, or they're after-school programs, and they're not considered as important. And if there's ever a budget cut, one or all five of them are the first to go out the window if they were there in the first place. And so the five other solids, to my way of thinking, are, in no order of priority here, the arts. And by that, I don't mean just, you know, an art class. I mean music, dance, filmmaking, drama, visual arts, and so on. And we'll get into that in a minute, because there's a financial implication to what I'm talking about. But let's hold off on just one second on that. So a whole rich program in the arts, so that kids can find out maybe what their passions and interests might be. Secondly, human development classes, a place where kids can actually talk about their life's issues and feel safe. And maybe I'll come back to that in just a second. The third one, physical education. And I don't mean just a football team and some cheerleaders. I mean a really imaginative physical education program that applies to all kids, fitness and nutrition and yoga and martial arts and whatever it happens to be. But it needs to be broad and diverse. The fourth, community service, community action, getting kids out there into the community and learning what the needs of their society are and how they might. We have now 10, 20, 30-year, and pretty soon 40-year reunions at Crossroads. And it's amazing how many kids I talk to who say, you know, that the course that really turned me around the most was my community service program. It gave me some ideas for what I might major in college and blah, blah, blah. And let's see, what have I forgotten? Fifth, environmental education. We all want to save the planet. We're all concerned about that. How are we going to do that if we graduate generations of kids who have never walked in a forest, never been to the ocean, never slept under the stars, have no relationship to the earth. How is that generation going to have the motivation and the passion to save this planet that is under such incredible assault by we human beings? So what is one of the biggest problems in inner city and low-income neighborhoods? Dropouts. Why are kids dropping out? Because they're disengaged. Why are they disengaged? Because we've cut out of the budget and out of the curriculum and out of the schools many of the areas that engage them. So if you go back to the five other solids that I just mentioned, what do they all five have in common? They're all hands-on, they're experiential, they're project-based. They get kids maybe off campus, out of the classroom, doing things that young people should be doing. I mean, what could be more unnatural than taking boys and girls who are 12, 13, 14, 16, and putting them in one room for 50 minutes and making them sit in the desk, and then sending them down the hall and making them sit for another 50 minutes, and then down the hall, sit for another 50 minutes, and so on. I think middle school kids should be put on a farm, and they should be up at 6 o'clock, you know, milking the cows and shoveling and whatever, and burning some of that energy off and learning how to do something. But anyway, I'm rambling. So the five other solids to me are desperately important, and they are areas in which so many kids discover and can discover who they are and what they might want to do with their lives. And I'll give you one little anecdote. One of the organizations that I helped start a number of years ago is called PS Arts. And we raise money to put the arts back into public schools. And so I was visiting one of these schools in the early years. And the principal told me a story that he was walking down the hall, and the third grade teacher walked by him and said, "Oh, you've got to come to my room and look at the self-portrait that Jose Valdez just finished. It's just incredible." And the principal looked at her and said, "What are you talking about? Jose was expelled 6 weeks ago." He was sneaking back to school to finish his art project. And, you know, we're all so concerned about dropouts. This was a drop-in, you know. And this was a kid who wanted to be able to say something about himself in a way that was really deeply important to him. And you take that out of the curriculum, and you don't give kids these opportunities for self-discovery. I think it's not only tragic, but it verges on being educationally criminal. You know? So,
and it should be noted, PS Arts provides public schools that can't afford art programs with free art programs. It's an amazing thing that yet another thing that we have to thank you for.
Well, it's a good thing, but it's also kind of sad that a nonprofit organization has to be out, you know, begging for money to put back into the schools what should be there in the first place.
So let's use that as an opportunity to transition into to America's Two Educations, and, you know, the message that you had in that book and the concerns you have and the vision you have for how things could be different.
Okay, good. I'd love to do that. Let me give you, if you can visualize this, one of those matching tests. So where you connect the line to the right answer. So I'm going to give you a column of four organizations, entities, and then I'm going to give you four numbers and see if you can connect them. A parochial school, a Crossroads, Harvard, Westlake, Marlboro, Brentwood, whatever, private school, an LAUSD, Los Angeles Unified School District, school, and a boys incarceration facility, of which there is one right up above you here called Camp David Gonzalez. Okay, so those are the four. Now your four numbers to try and connect with are $3,000, $10,000, $37,000, $200,000. Okay, and those are per pupil numbers. Okay, so anybody want to venture a guess? Where does the 3,000 connect to? The parochial school. Yeah, the low income Catholic school in a relatively poor, you know, with a poor clientele. The 10,000 LAUSD. The 37,000 Crossroads, Harvard, Westlake, Brentwood, Marlboro, and the 200,000 Camp David Gonzales. Now, I've heard different people in probation and in the county say, oh no, it's only 125, it's only 150,000 a year to lock a boy up for, to fund a bed for a year in one of these incarceration facilities. To me, that's a little bit, you know, kind of upside down. And I don't believe it has to be that way. So what, but let's take the, eliminating the two fringe numbers, the 3,000 and the roughly 200,000. Let's take a look at the 37,000 at your independent school and the 10, roughly 10, maybe 11,000 in an LAUSD school. And I maintain that, you can do a lot more with $37,000 per pupil than you can with 11. And most public school principals will say, yeah, I could do a lot more if I had 37 per pupil than if I had 11. And people say, well, Paul, what would you do? What would you do to improve public education if you could? I'd say, well, there are three or four things I'd do right away. And focusing on inner city schools, for example, I'd cut the class size in half. So I gave a talk recently at LA High. I've done some consulting at Jordan High School, at Manual Arts High School, at Crenshaw High School, and a typical teacher there will have five classes a day of maybe 40 students, maybe 50 students. And I, when I was an English teacher starting out at my old high school, Harvard, I had four 12th grade English classes of 12 kids per class. I could assign an essay every 2 weeks, a draft every week, get it back, have them reading, you know, a stack of novels and plays and poetry anthologies and so on and so on. And we could have wonderful class discussions, and I could sit down with them individually and go over their essays and show them how to do this and that. I could teach. The teaching conditions enabled me to teach. If I had five classes a day of 40 kids, forget it. So cut the class size in half, and people say, wait a minute, that means you have to hire 100% more teachers. I say, yeah. Oh, okay. Well, what else would you do? Well, I'd pay those teachers more so that we could attract into the teaching field the best minds of our college graduates, the top one-third, rather than what we get now, which I'm sure no teacher in this room falls in that category, but the bottom third of college graduates are going into teaching. The so-called Finland model is find the very best teachers, pay them a lot to get them to come into the best graduates of in college, pay them a lot to go into teaching, give them massive training, and then give them the freedom in the classroom to be who they are. We do just the opposite of those four things. We don't go after the top graduates. We don't pay them very well. We don't train them. And then we put them in a classroom and put shackles around them and say, you got to prepare for this test, this high stakes test, and so on and so on. And that's how you're going to be judged, is how well your kids do on your testing. But that's another issue. So, so then now that I've cut the class size in half, hired 100% more teachers, and now I'm paying them better, then I would put into the curriculum the five other solids that have been budget cut out of existence. So I'd put the arts and environmental ed and human development and community service and physical education back into the program so that the kids in public education get as exciting and diverse a curriculum as the kids who go to Crossroads. And people will say, oh, that's just, come on, Paul, that's just elitist education for wealthy kids. I say, no, it's not elitist education. It's quality education. And by the way, 42% of the student body are students of color. So it's a far more integrated school than the vast majority of LAUSD schools. So if you've got a school district that's 90% non-white, it's pretty hard to have an integrated school. So anyway, so those are kind of the numbers. And And I, you know, with the 37,000, you get everything I've been talking about, and with the 10,000, you don't. And it just seems to me unfair. Why should kids in one America get every advantage, and kids who desperately need it even more in another area of America, they don't get it? It doesn't seem right. We ought to do something about it.
So with Crossroads and New Roads, you reinvented progressive education.
Progressive education has been around for a long time, and there are wonderful progressive schools around the country. It's just that in the 70s when we created Crossroads, there weren't too many schools doing some of the things that we started doing in those days. So I'm not sure I mean.
You expanded.
Yeah. We expanded.
The vision of progressive education.
I mentioned human development programs. And I'll tell you one quick little anecdote. I was in my office one day at Crossroads, and a senior girl walked in and just unannounced and just plopped on the couch and kind of sat there in my office looking at me. And then she said, "Tomorrow, tomorrow, tomorrow." She said, "Is that all you adults ever think about?" And, you know, I'm the head of this, what I think is this wonderfully humanistic progressive school. And I kind of looked at her and I said, what are you talking about? And she said, "All I hear is study hard so tomorrow you can do well on your quiz, so that tomorrow you can get a good grade in this class, so tomorrow your GPA will be good, so tomorrow you'll do well on the SATs, so tomorrow you get into a quality college, prestige college." She said, "Tomorrow, tomorrow." She said, "When do I get to enjoy today?" And then she got up and walked out. I'm just sitting there feeling like I've been bludgeoned. And I happened to mention this to a friend of mine who was kind of my mentor, guru, and I think a brilliant man, a guy named Jack Zimmerman, who some of you may know of. And I told this anecdote to Jack, and he said, "Well, why don't you give kids a place to talk about issues like that?" So he told me about this thing called council, you know, where you sit in a circle and you have a talking piece that goes around the circle, and you're supposed to speak from the heart when it's your turn. You're supposed to listen, you know, with an open heart. You're supposed to be brief, and you can pass if you want, and everything that happens in the council is supposed to be confidential and stay there. So I said, "God, that sounds great. Would you put it in for us?" And he said, So we started with the seniors. And to make a long story short, it's grown so that it's now K-12. And the kids find it one of the great gifts that the school gives to them, a place where they can talk about their life issues, feel safe, and just the very act of being able to discuss some of these issues is therapeutic, even though it's not group therapy. So anyway, that's... I don't know how I got into that, but
we were talking about expanding the vision of progressive.
Yeah, so that was kind of a new program, and now that's spread to a lot of schools are doing it. And the other thing we did is we put in community service early on as a graduation requirement, and most of the schools weren't doing that at that time, so that was a little bit of an innovation. But you know, there have been progressive education, wonderful schools going way, way back in this country.
So here we sit in 2016. I was about to say 2012. Time flies. And a lot's changed. Mm-hmm. A lot's changed since they started this desk vision of school in the 1800s. And a lot's changed since 1971. And a lot's changed since the internet and, you know, now Google, you can look anything up, and the need to memorize has changed, and all sorts of things have changed. So I'm curious, and I'm going to ask this question. I think we'll sum up and we'll go to Q&A.
Okay, good.
I'm curious what's your vision for what a great quality education looks like today and going forward, preparing kindergartens who are going to be 21 in 2033?
I mean, that's a 2-hour question.
I'll stick around.
My initial take on that question is going to sound a little mealy mouth, but I hope I can make it not be mealy mouth. And that is, I think there needs to be a certain balance, and the balance needs to be between the new technology and being familiar with all the new technology and learning how to make it work for you, but at the same time, being able to read and to read the classics and to be able to think critically. I'm just so concerned about kids whose lives seem to be, you know, dictated by their two thumbs, and I would like to have graduates of all of our schools being able to read Dostoevsky and Dickens and Faulkner and Shakespeare, and actually have read an entire play and not just an excerpt, and be able to write a really quality essay. So, and that's what you do get, by the way, in independent schools and in some public schools and super wealthy, you know, communities and so on, where the class size is reasonable and kids are coming from families that are college, you know, where there's one or two college graduates in the family and so on. But in the two Americas right now, the disparity of opportunity and programs between low-income America and high-income America is pretty stunning, and something that I think we all need to pay attention to. So how do we keep that balance? How do we stay innovative when we think we've discovered something? And you asked me that question when we talked earlier.
Yeah.
How does a school that has done some exciting innovations keep innovating? And well, one thing you need, I think, the leaders of the schools need to hire teachers who are always pushing out at the edge. And as an administrator, it's tempting not to hire teachers like that because they're a pain in the ass. But if your school's going to grow and be exciting, then you've got to have teachers who are themselves growing and who are exciting and who want to try new things. You need to listen to the kids, but not be dictated to by the kids. So that's where this balance comes in, where young people have an opportunity to pursue their passions and hobbies and interests, but that they also graduate being able to read and write and think. And so, you know, it's an exciting, challenging time. And if we somehow get in the public schools beyond this obsession with testing and get back to what are really the most important things, and then to keep asking ourselves the question that to me is the most important question, and that is, are kids actually enjoying their education? I mean, it's a short life. Why would we want to squeeze the joy out of education for some adult misconception of what's important? Why isn't waking up in the morning excited about going to school the most important thing? So, I mean, we need to keep asking ourselves that question. So I don't know if I answered your question.
It's perfect. So, to sum up, you've already done one part of the work. My summing up question is, what are your top three things that make a quality school? And I think the joy of going to school sounds like it's number one on your list. Give me two more.
Two more would be I think the most important thing is finding exciting teachers to put in the classroom with kids. I just read an article in Education Week of a couple of recent studies that have come out showing that students who are getting their entire education online are not doing very well. That personal relationship with a teacher, to me, is still important, which means you have to hire teachers who are not afraid to have relationships with students and care about them and show them interest and give them a little encouragement along the way. And then wherever you can, to find teachers who, and it's very subjective, but who create magic in the classroom. And you know it when you see it, but you can't, you know, it's pretty hard to run an ad. Wanted teacher who can create magic in the classroom, you know. So you have to watch them teach before you hire them and see if there is that kind of wild, kooky, crazy, zany, goofy, wonderful kind of quality. And then I guess, you know, what do I say, joy, exciting teachers, and then a rich curriculum. And again, we kind of come back to money, but that's probably another topic for another day.
Awesome. Thank you so much. So now it's time for question and answers. And I think we'll use my microphone. And are you going to hand it around? Okay, perfect.
Hi.
Hey.
My son went to your school. I remember the day that he got in. It was one of the happiest days of my life when he got into Crossroads many years ago. But that's not my question. What you said at the very end, Paul, I'm an educator. I'm an educational therapist. So I work with kids that have learning differences. And there, what you said at the very last few minutes really stimulated something in my thinking, which I want to ask you about. If teachers, if that magic of teaching, if that connection with a teacher that is interesting and stimulating is so very important, I wonder what you think about so many families now turning to homeschooling, as some of my families are doing.
Well, I mean, I think you have to. Why, did everybody hear the question? Why are so many people turning to homeschooling? And I suppose the answer is that there are different answers for different families. Large public schools tend not to be able to deal with kids who have kind of special interests. So I know of one kid who comes to my home every week because my wife's a private piano teacher. And this kid could no more, he's a wonderful kid. He's smart. He's a little bit kind of goofy and wonderful. And a little spacey, and his mother is homeschooling him, and he could no more go to Crossroads, or and he's very smart, Crossroads, Harvard, Westlake, wherever, and go from one classroom to another, and then do homework, all night, because he's a monster piano player. I mean, he's just extraordinary, and he needs his day to practice the piano, but it would be nice if he could find a place that would accommodate him. So that he could have a social context, because he's a little socially inept, and so many schools that their rules are so rigid that they can't accommodate a kid like this. And I called a school recently to see if they'd be interested in taking a kindergarten boy who was a chess master at 5 years of age. Oh, well, no, we couldn't. I mean, he would have to be in the classroom all day. I said, why couldn't he be there just for part of the day and then go off to for his lessons with his chess master? Oh, no, we have to. And I remember at the end of her junior year, a number of years ago when I was the headmaster at Crossroads, this wonderful girl came in to see me and she said, look, I'm going to make playing the violin my career. I know that now. And she was incredible. And she actually had jumped a plateau and was about to jump another one in her playing. She said, I'd love to come back to Crossroads for my senior year, but I only want to take two classes. And I said, great. And I said, I don't know, you probably won't have enough credits to graduate, but that's not going to be a problem. Every college in America is going to want you anyhow. And she's now the associate concert master of the New York Philharmonic. Mm. So should I have said to her, no, you can't come back because you have to take four academic solids and you have to have your diploma, otherwise you can't be here. I'm like, come on, why would I do that? So if the schools were a little more flexible, then maybe a lot of parents would feel less like they had to homeschool their kids. And if the schools were a little bit more joyful, maybe they'd feel more comfortable sending their kids off. And if maybe they were more intellectually challenging, some of them, and so on. Another question, maybe? There's one there.
Do you have any thoughts on how, as a community, we start to institute change, sort of at the community level and then at the national level? I'm recently, the last two or three years, been more involved in education. I was surprised both at my own ignorance around the issues of education, and then I'm surprised at the lack of involvement in the community with the issues of education, right? And coming up with a presidential election, I don't think I've heard education mentioned once. I know it's not an easy question, but I'm just curious your own thoughts about how to drive change.
How do we get it to become more part of the national dialogue? God, I wish I knew the answer to that one. It seems to me that we can't really look for it to be top down. That it's got to come from everybody in this room, and it's got to come from grassroots organizations all over the country, and we need to just demand that our political system provide better support of our schools, We talked just briefly about the per pupil. Why are we willing to spend somewhere between $150,000 and $200,000 a year to lock a kid up and only $10,000 to educate him or her? So our priorities are kind of all screwed up, and we need to get a little bit angry about that. And the federal government provides about that much of the educational budget. Why? I mean, the federal government is willing to fund 1,000 military bases around the globe, but not provide your textbooks for inner city schools. So, you know, we need to get angry, and we need to push our legislators and the people that we elect to, you know, to ask the question that you're asking, and to push. I don't know any other answer to it. I mean, I try to write books about it, but, you know, they're not New York Times bestsellers. So. Yes. Thank you all.
1 minute. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thanks. That was so great fun. Yeah.
Thank you very much.